Welcome back. So on this video, we're going to focus on why 5G, why Helium Network, is it profitable? So for context, Freedom Fi has just released a small cell radio, which is designed for indoor use. And they posted a picture of on Twitter of them testing their indoor small cell on top of their headquarters in Boulder, Colorado. So let's take a look at that. But before I do, this is just the setup. I'm not spending a lot of time on this, but that is the setup that you would need to do some indoor small cell stuff. So this is what we're talking about. Why is it worth it to buy this equipment here? So let's take a look at this. Why Helium? Why 5G? Why now? So we have this Freedom Fi launching this radio. Freedom Fi tweeted out that they're even doing some testing with an indoor small cell on top of their headquarters here in Boulder, Colorado. Well, not here, but in this picture. So they have the indoor small cell, and they said that that's about 1,000 feet of coverage, or about three times the normal coverage of an enterprise access point. They're estimating that the outdoor coverage is 5 to 7 miles in line of sight. And that's very important to understand that 5G just doesn't go through walls, windows, or trees very well. Line of sight is key for indoor and outdoor both, because conditions degrade dramatically when line of sight is impeded. So why now? Why? How did we get here? Well, Freedom Fi is using this new spectrum called CBRS, and it was made available in January of 2020. That spectrum was previously used by the military, but they opened it for usage without a license. We're going to talk about that a little bit later. So if you watched my video on putting up a tower, which I'll put in the description, you'll know these licenses for communications are rife with inspections. They're really costly. And, you might have to rent some tower space and just for the equipment. It's a lot of investment. So very soon, Freedom Fi will release that outdoor radio. And that will be really helpful in augmenting these dead zones or eliminating the dead zones that just big telecom won't invest to cover. And we're going to set up or talk a little bit more about that in the coming slides here. Where's 5G right now? Well, most metropolitan areas. It's being built in the country too, where it's worth investment. I mean, that's what it comes down to, is where it's economical and, say, lucrative for big telecoms to soak up that 5G money from subscribers. Well, there you go. They'll put them up. But the key is, where isn't it? So if you have a backhaul, that means if you have a connection to like an ISP, you can connect this equipment together and build out your own 5G coverage. And so really just the simple aspect of it for where it's applicable is, well, where it's not worth it for big telecom to invest in infrastructure, but it is worth it for you to invest in infrastructure. And then we'll talk about some more of those things, the coffee shops, gymnasiums, or other dead zones to elevation, due to elevation or physical impediments to signals, such as buildings, just where the usage is not maybe high enough or warranted for big telecom to come in and build their own towers. How much does this setting up cost? So these are rough numbers here. For an indoor 5G setup, you're looking at it probably about $3K. And for outdoor, you're gonna pay a lot more, probably $4K to $10K, depending on your setup. So let's break down those numbers. Obviously you have your bandwidth via your ISP, and then you have the miner, which costs $1,000 right now. The CBRS radio, which attaches to the miner, and then that's $1,600. It might even be more applicable to go back to the setup here. So you got your small your Freedom Fi miner, which costs $1,000. This thing costs $1,600 right now, and the outdoor version of this will probably be about $2,300. And then if you're augmenting, doing some antenna upgrades, then it's going to be about $2,500 to $5,000 to do that setup. And then if you're going to build a tower, which I have, that's going to cost you probably another $2,500 or so. And that's if you're buying used and building yourself. So there's a bunch more that you're going to soak up. Some other odds and ends, antennas, connecting your equipment. It could be a couple hundred to a couple thousand dollars, depending on how much you want to invest in your setup, your networking equipment, your UPSs, and all that kind of stuff. So these are some ballpark numbers, but from my experience so far in the indoor setup to doing the outdoor potential is that's where it's running. So if you spend all that money, is it going to be worth it? That's a very, very important question. So, before I answer that question, I really want to call out Multicoin Capital's article on the Helium flywheel. It's very important to understand how Helium works and how it generates revenue and just all that, the tokenomics around that. Using crypto is kind of hard for people to understand, so it's well worth it to check that out and see how the economics of it drive the profitability of it as well, and how it keeps churning in on itself to support a profitable economic system. Over the next couple slides, we're going to cover just how Helium's earnings are split, and that how those rewards are calculated. And that's from data transfer right now, though proof of coverage is coming later. And then, we're going to do some math, just easy math, rough math too. So, and then are there any risks to long-term viability, right? You spent lots of money setting up your setup, and then could something come in and just take it out? Or could Helium fall over or whatever? We'll take a look at that as well. So here's Helium's earnings breakdown for at least the first year. And this is still current as of their website. So 30% goes to network data transfer, 35% to hotspot infrastructure, and then another 35% to the to Helium itself and the investors. So this is important to understand how the AT&T tokens are minted and rewarded accordingly. So looking at that breakdown over time of earnings, we're at the left side of this chart. We're at pretty much year zero, year one, year two, kind of in that range. So over time, as these events occur, halvings and the like, these earnings will change. So you can see that the core component is network data transfer. In building out the coverage, you have the data transfer and the proof of coverage, which it serves as a chicken and an egg trying to meet that problem. So the proof of coverage makes sure that we have a network to use, and then the data transfer measures actual usage. So that's very important to understanding that balance of when we've crossed that chicken and egg problem. Long-term, data transfer is going to come up more and more and more. You're going to be rewarded for that right now, but in the future, you will be rewarded more for proof for network data transfer. For proof of coverage, though, right now that's where a lot of the earnings are coming from. Now it's still equal between them, but long term, proof of coverage will go down as the network grows, and it's just there and ubiquitous. And then the data transfer will take over, and that's where all the earnings will be. All right, so this Helium 5G miner setup that I showed you, how much is it gonna make you? Well, let's go through the math. So small cells can transmit about 150 megabits per second. So if you calculate that out, that's a 1 gigabyte every 6.66 seconds. And for in a minute, so you're going at peak rate. This is a best case scenario where we're trying to just max out earnings. Picture at a gymnasium where there's a lot of people trying to use usage or live stream some sort of event or something like that. So for 1 minute, that's about 9 gigabytes total. Now you take that 1 minute of maximum bandwidth usage, and that's about $4.50 per the 50 cents per gigabyte suggested in HIP 27. And that is not, as far as I understand, that is not passed yet. It is not approved. And so that's just an idea. So if you take that $4.50 per gigabyte on that 9 gigabytes, per hour, that is $270 an hour. So you can do the math from there. 10 hours of usage is $2,700. You know, 20 hours would be whatever, twice that, right? So upwards of almost near $6,000 for 20 hours of usage. So you're getting up there, probably $6,000 a day if you had peak usage 24/7, which of course probably wouldn't happen, but that's where it's lucrative and where big telecom really wants to put all of their, you know, their towers around, you know, stadiums and that kind of stuff. It's very lucrative there, but you probably won't make that much, you know, in a coffee shop or something like that, but you never know. It's all based on usage. So keep in mind that this data transfer is at a one-to-one ratio up to 30% of the total rewards, which will increase over time as proof of coverage is still important. So as I talked about that graph, you'll get more rewards for data transfer long-term. But there's also proof of coverage rewards coming for 5G as well. So one last note on these earnings, the ratio of LoRa earnings versus 5G earnings is being discussed in HIP 37 as it relates to proof of coverage. So HIP 37, if you aren't understanding what a HIP is, it's a Helium Improvement Proposal. That's how the decentralized community of Helium makes their decisions. They put forth these HIPs and ideally, there's code to go along with it as well. And then they're just tweaking some of the variables that are maybe in disagreement, and then they talk about it and agree on it. So that's kind of how it's floating out. Of course, there's lots of beta testing that's going on with, you know, looking at the usage here. So it's very, very important to keep in mind all these numbers. But yeah, so per hour peak usage, $270, you know, maybe. We'll have to see. Talking about the risks, can anything stop Helium 5G? And the short answer is no. I don't think so. But what about airlines or the FCC or big telecom? I'll go with you there. So let's go through some of these. So for spectrum restrictions, this is license free. So it's free for everybody to use. And as long as you're not infringing on other licensed spectrum, you know, and that could be done by augmenting your antenna incorrectly. If you're not infringing, then you're going to be fine. Recently there was an article about a proposed delay to 5G made by airplane manufacturers. And I saw this article and I clicked on it and I'm like, oh my gosh, this sucks. And I kept digging into it. And this is where the do your research, right? It really helps. So one of the instruments targets the spectrum in the middle of big telecom's 5G spectrum. Fortunately for us, CBRS spectrum is well outside of that spectrum. It's like two totally different things. If you want to, I posted on Twitter, I think on the Helium Discord as well, and just kind of got the official answers to agree with me. So not a big deal there, but something to mention. So it's also not cost effective for big telecoms to build coverage in dead zones or where there's infrequent usage. You know, if that $270, you know, for them, it's probably not worth it to come in, and then they'd have to create relationships with local people who are willing to maintain that. And it's just, it's not cost effective for them to do that. And they got to pay potentially pay people healthcare and all that kind of stuff. And here, if we're just doing it ourselves, then it's just naturally rewarding it, and costs come down. So this is why this is so much more economical, and to the point that big telecoms may even develop agreements with Helium in the future to offload usage to our towers and such, because it's not economical for them to build their own coverage. Now they might look, potentially analyze that and be like, maybe we should invest more in this area, but if we built it, then they might just use our stuff instead. So think back to my point earlier about the military spectrum that the CBRS came from. If people were infringing upon that spectrum, odds are someone would have come knocking at their door, right? Hey, you're using military spectrum. This is for military uses only, you know, stop, and, you know, fines and all that kind of stuff, threats of maybe jail. I don't know. But So this is very like protected spectrum. So there it was. Now it's pretty open. So I think we're at an advantage there. So bottom line, my hot take is I feel like we're very much in a safe spot here with as much research as I've done. And the one thing that provides a lot of hope, excitement, if you want to take it that way, is that if Dish Network merges this spectrum space that they already own, then it could create even wider, stronger, better coverage and make it easier for us to create, you know, awesome setups that would go farther, you know, just be better. So there's a really good case for Dish Network using that in the long term. So I hope you've enjoyed this video about Helium and the profitability and what you would need to do for setting up your own 5G. I also have another video that you can watch about all the equipment behind me, how you would set it up, and obviously buying all the equipment, guides and everything. So you can check that out. I even have videos about building your own tower and just the LoRa side of mining. What is Helium? Just going back to that. I have an entire course to go back and you can watch all of those videos from setting up the LoRa side of that. So there's more than enough information out there for you. I invite you to check it out. Always appreciate your comments down below. And if I'm ever wrong, which occasionally I am, I love correcting myself and I will put that in a pinned comment below. Please like, subscribe, ring that bell so that you know exactly when I upload a video. Thank you for your time and attention. And I'm so excited for building this 5G network. It's going to be so much fun. Carpe Tempestis, everyone. See the storm.